Good afternoon. I want to thank everyone for attending the Nonprofit Resource Hub Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion webinar. My name is Danette O'Connell, the president of the Nonprofit Resource Hub, also known as NRH. Who is NRH? NRH is a trade association whose mission is to serve, be a resource to, educate, and connect its members to the nonprofit community. At the same time, NRH serves the nonprofit sector as a bridge connecting nonprofits to resources and to each other. You can find additional information at www.nonprofitresourcehub.org. The organization is founded by five members: Serenian Associates, Sir Tilbin Ballin Attorneys, Nonprofit Sector Strategies, Triumph International, Vanguard Insurance. Also, our website is now up and running. We encourage all nonprofits to become nonprofit partners. There's no cost to the nonprofits, and there's lots of benefits. Some of the benefits are you can add your events to our calendar for others to see. You can post articles, and you can review articles on our website. And there's much more benefits that you can check out on our website. So please go there. Again, the website is www.nonprofitresourcehub.org. Also, I want to thank our associate members, which are PMP Staffing, Premier Payroll, Powered by Professionals, Five Star Advertising, Morgan Stanley, Financial Advisors, Sterling Risk, Lee, and Sir Tilbin Ballin Attorneys. At the end of the webinar, you will be receiving a survey. Please take the survey so that we know what you want from what you prefer from us, and let us know how we did on the webinar. Future events, we will have events. We're going to try to do them every 2 months, if not every quarter, but please check out our website so that you know when our next events are. So this event, after the intro, we will have Ama Karikari-Yawson, which will be doing the webinar, and then we'll have a Q&A, and then Ken Serini will be doing our closing. So without further ado, I want to introduce Ama Karikari-Yawson. Ama, thank you.
Hello, 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 hello. Thank you, Danette. And I want to thank your wonderful organization for having me here. Since we spoke on the phone a few weeks ago, I've been very excited to learn more about what your organization is doing in terms of making sure that nonprofits are streamlined and are efficient and that they have access to the best resources possible so that they can do their amazing work of empowering the world. So thank you so much. I'm very honored to be here.
Thank you for coming.
Great, 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 great. So I will introduce myself. My name is Ama Karikari-Yawson, and I am an author and an educator. I am sometimes very surprised myself about the work that I am doing right now as an author, speaker, and educator, because I did not start out like this, and I did not start out ever thinking that I would do this. I went a very traditional route. Went to prep school, went to Harvard undergrad. After Harvard undergrad, worked in investment banking for many years, left investment banking to go to law school at the University of Pennsylvania Law School, as well as get my MBA from the Wharton School, and then went on to become a corporate lawyer at a white shoe law firm called Cleary Gottlieb Steen & Hamilton, and then went in-house at Citigroup. And so you may be asking, how is it that this lady has pivoted from being an attorney? And I was a corporate attorney in the security space. I used to write bond disclosure. I used to write about when the bonds would mature. I would write about the risk associated with it. That was my work for many years. But then I had an experience that really caused me to pivot, and that experience was some time ago. So everyone, I am a mom of two kids. I have a 10-year-old boy named JoJo and an 8-year-old boy named Miles. And way back when JoJo was 3 years old, I took him to the barbershop one day. So I took him to the barbershop to get his haircut. Now, this should have been just a regular, mundane, routine experience of just getting a child a haircut, but it actually became something much deeper. I took him to the barbershop and I asked the barber not to shave off all his hair because That's what barbers love to do. They said, this is a fidgety toddler. The best cut is to just shave it off, make it smooth, et cetera. This is easy. And I said, no. Please don't shave it all off. I would like him to have more style, make it a little higher. So I then proceeded, the barber then proceeded to start basically shaving all his hair off from the top and the middle. And when I said, hey, you know, what are you doing? I told you not to shave this all off. The barber said, you have a real N-I-G-G-A right here. He is a native boy from the tribe. This is not pretty hair. This kinky hair is not pretty hair. This is the best cut for him. And I was really taken aback by that. I am not among the people of African descent who uses such pejorative terms. And again, he was using the pejorative term in a negative way, saying that kinky hair is not pretty hair. It's not the best hair. This is the type of hair that you just shave all off. And at the back of the barber shop, there was a woman who was clearly bleached. So unfortunately, in many communities of African, Asian, and indigenous descent, people use products with a chemical in it called hydroquinone to bleach their skin. And this lady's skin was bleached. Let's say her hands were like the complexion of my hands, were a deep brown. Her face was a lighter brown like Beyonce. And so it really got me thinking about the issue of self-love, self-acceptance, as well as racism, both internalized and externalized. Now, the next day, I would also get a sign that this is an issue that I should be thinking about. Basically, the next day, I was watching a show called The Fashion Police with the late Joan Rivers and Kelly Osbourne and so forth. And they were critiquing various, you know, fashion. They were critiquing Solange Knowles at the Great Gatsby premiere. And Joan Rivers made this comment. Solange Knowles looks fine in her dress and all that, but how could she wear an afro, a kinky, big, round, fluffy afro to the red carpet? Joan Rivers said, I like afros just as much as anyone else, but not to the red carpet. And so this made me think again, oh my goodness, why is there so much hatred in the world, right? No one chooses their skin color. No one chooses their hair texture, right? I'm someone who has kinky hair. My own hair is kinkier than this. Why would there be so much lack of self-acceptance? And so this actually caused me to want to write a story to teach a lesson about self-acceptance. And I wrote a story. This is the first book. Now I've written many books, but this is the first book, Sune's Gift. And this story is about diversity, inclusion, and self-acceptance. And once I wrote the book and I did a Kickstarter and I published the book, I started speaking out on issues of diversity, inclusion, and equity. And that is what we are going to speak about today. I'm going to perform this story for you because in my speaking with Danette, she said, we want this to be an interesting interactive event. So I'm actually going to perform the story for you from memory. I want you to just please, you know, take off your too cool for school attitude and come to an attitude of acceptance and love and openness because I'm going to perform this story. Afterwards, we are going to talk about what is diversity, what is inclusion, what is equity. We are going to define those terms. We are going to discuss institutional racism, and we are also going to explain and discuss explicit bias, implicit bias, microaggressions, all these terms that you've heard swirling around in this new age, but you may not necessarily know exactly what people are referring to. We're going to dig deep, discuss those terms, discuss how racism and lack of diversity, equity, and inclusion is affecting us, how we all play a part. And then what we are also going to do is we are going to seize our power during this session to ensure that our world is a more diverse, inclusive, and equitable world. And we're going to make sure that all of us know that we have the power to make changes, both small and large. Are you with me? So everyone, This is supposed to be interactive. I need you to tell me you're with me in the chat. We have 66 attendees. I need to see something in the chat letting me know that I'm not speaking to just, you know, cyberspace. Can someone put in the chat, I'm with you, Ama? Can you write that? You're with me, Nicholas? I appreciate you. Oh yeah, here we go. Kara, Melania, Deb, Denise, Frank. Yes, 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 yes. You are with me and I'm with you too. Love to see it in the chat. This makes me know that you are here because all of you are muted, so I can't hear you. So I need to see you in the chat. Thank you. So now I'm going to perform this book. Now, my parents are from Ghana in West Africa, and we are a part of an ethnicity called the Akan, A-K-A-N, Akan. Among the Akan are many different sub-ethnicities, such as the Ashanti and the Fanti. And among the Akan cultures, we have a culture of storytelling. And our belief is that a storyteller and the people listening, oh, my daughter's from Ghana, she's Ashanti. Excellent, excellent, excellent. Oh my goodness, wonderful. Tell her Ghanaian sister says hello, Akwaba. That means welcome in our language. So in our ethnicity, when we start a story, we start with a call and response. So I'm going to call and you are going to respond. The call is Ago, A-G-O-O. Your response is Ame, A-M-E. Ame, A-M-E. I just put it in the chat so you see it. Ame. I'm going to say Ago. I want you to write in the chat Ame. From your own offices or wherever you are, I want you to say Ame out loud as well as write it. And we are going to say Ago and Ame two times. We're going to have a moment of silence and then I'm going to perform this story for you. All right? So, quiz. I say Ago. What do you say? Someone write in the chat. Oh, you all are bright, bright, sharp whippersnappers. That's what I like to see. I say I'll go, you say I may. Moment of silence. I'm performing this story, and then we're digging deep into this topic of diversity and inclusion. All right, we're going to start. I'll go, I may. Moment of silence, starting the story. I'll go and I may twice. Moment of silence, starting the story. I'll go, I may. I'll go. Ame. In the beginning, the planet of Wiasi was not as it is today. There was no sun to bring forth warmth or light. There was no earth from which fruits, trees, vegetables, or flowers could grow. There was no water to quench the thirst of the living, and there was no wind to transport seeds or cause a refreshing breeze. Now, the creator of the planet was named Niami, and Niami became very bored with this barren planet. So in an instant and with just a thought, Niami brought forth the sun, the earth, the water, and the wind, and everyone, it was beautiful. Lush vegetation was growing from the brilliant earth, and the sounds of water flowing and breezes blowing created a beautiful melody. It was good. So good, Niami said, I am going to make children to help me take care of this world. So in an instant and with just a thought, Niami brought forth four children. They were magical, magical beings called Magdis, and their names were Sune, Earthe, Watre, and Winde. Niami began to address the Magdis. The first Magdi that Niami addressed was Sune. And Niami said, Sune, you are imbued with the power of the sun. For this reason, your skin is sun dark and red, and your hair grows and spirally twists toward the sun. Take care of yourself because the power of the sun is within you. The next child was Earthe. And Niami said, Earthe, you are imbued with the power of the earth. For this reason, your skin is brown and your straight hair grows down toward the soil. Take care of yourself because the power of the earth is within you. The next child was Watre, and Niami said, Watre, you are imbued with the power of water. For this reason, your skin is translucent green, and your straight hair flows down your back like water. Take care of yourself, because the water is within you. And the next child was Winde, and Niami said to Winde, Winde, you are imbued with the power of wind. For this reason, your skin is gray, and your straight hair blows with the breeze. Take care of yourself because the power of the wind is within you. Niami then said, you are all my children made in my image. Honor each other and honor each other's gifts. So now these four Magbys were very responsible. They had to do dances to make the sun rise and set, to put nutrients into the soil, to make it rain and to make the wind blow. And as they would do their dances, they would sing this song, repeat after me from your chairs. Funga alafia, ashe, ashe. Funga alafia, ashe, ashe. So soon they would do a wave dance to make the sun rise and set and would sing funga alafia, ashe, ashe. And earth, they would do hip circles to put nutrients into the soil. Funga alafia, ashe, ashe. And water would do finger jiggles to make it rain. Funga alafia, ashe, ashe. And wind, they would blow out gaseous gusts of air to transport seats to new places and would sing funga alafia, ashe, ashe. Now in their spare time, the four Magbys would play hide and seek, they play tag, they would also sing prim pranana, prim pranana. We are having so much fun, prim pranana, prim pranana, taking care of the world for everyone. But then one day, the four Magbys traveled to a river. For the first time, they looked at their reflections. As they looked at their reflections, it occurred to them that Sune, the sun child, looked different. You see, Earth Day, Water Day, and Wind Day all had hair that grew straight down. But Sune's hair stood tall. At first, Earth Day was confused about the difference and said, I wonder why Niami gave Sune different hair. Wind Day was jealous and wanted to be the one with the special hair. So Wind Day jealously blurted, Sune, your hair is ugly. Your spirally twists look absolutely ridiculous. Now, Water Day knew that Sune's hair was beautiful, but did not want to feel left out. So Water Day said, yeah, Sune, your hair is really weird. Sune's heart sank. Tears formed in Sune's eyes. Sune didn't want to be different, ugly, ridiculous, or weird. So Sune picked up a stick and began to beat every spiral of hair to make it straight. And with each slap, Sune's head ached. But Sune continued. As the other Magby said, you must, it's worth the fuss. Soon you will look like the rest of us. But when the last spiral of Sune's hair became straight, all of Sune's hair fell out. And the sun disappeared. Darkness descended upon the land. Sune, Earth Day, Water Day, and Wind Day looked at each other in horror. Sune tried to do the wave dance again and again to get the sun back. Funga alafia, ashe, ashe. But still there was no sun. So then Earth Day, Water Day, and Wind Day tried. Funga alafia, funga shay, shay, fung shay, 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 fung, fung, lay, lay, bay, eh, eh. They didn't even know what they were doing. Still there was no sun. At that moment, the words of Niami came to them. Sune, you are imbued with the power of the sun. For this reason, your skin is sun dark and red, and your hair grows in spirally twist toward the sun. Take care of yourself, because the power of the sun dwells within you. By destroying Sune's gift of spirally hair, they had destroyed Sune's gift of the sun. The silver glow of the moon did not provide enough light for their games. All of the trees, all of the corn, and all the vegetation began to die. In their collective grief, they chanted, Niami, Niami, we're so sorry for what we have done. We've destroyed our gift of the sun. Oh, how can our mistake be undone? They could feel Niami's presence, but they could not hear Niami's voice, so they just sat and cried. Finally, Niami spoke, and Niami said, my children, I forgive you all, and I see that you have learned your lesson. I made no mistakes creating you all with your different skin tones, hair textures, and features. You all are equal in your power, but distinct in your gifts. So don't you ever, ever, ever destroy your own gift because you covet someone else's. At that moment, Sune's spirally twist grew back and the four Magbys jumped up and down with glee, thanking Niami. They then returned to the river and looked at their reflections, and soon they said, I shouldn't have destroyed my gift of spirally here. My gift of spirally here is what makes me special, and whatever makes me special makes me great. And then they all sang, Sune is beautiful, we can't deny. In Sune's here, the sun's power lies. We are all special in our own way. We should celebrate each other every day. And the four Magpies lived happily ever after until the next episode, which is actually called Earth Day's Gift, which is another book which is available. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you for listening and taking off your too cool for school to enjoy a story. So everyone, tell me what your thoughts on the stories are. Tell me. Thank you. Wow, fantastic. I really appreciate that. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Frank Orzo, that was great. Great message. Marlo, great message, great story. Thank you, thank you, thank you. So tell me, what is the message of this work? What are the morals or messages of the story? Can you please put that in the chat? Please put in the chat what you believe the story's message is. Okay, because we're going to talk about that, and that is going to lead our discussion with respect to diversity and inclusion. And this story is available on Amazon. I'm putting the link, the Amazon link in the chat, because I hope that some of you would want to give this story away as a gift. There may be some birthday parties coming up and whatnot, and you want to share it. So please do. I just put it in the chat. The name of it is Sune's Gift. So thank you. Treasure each other's differences and gifts. I appreciate that, Denise. Really, really great. Samantha Clark, beyond acceptance, we should celebrate other people's difference. I love it. I love it. I love it. Even though we are all different, we need each other. Thank you. We need each other. I appreciate that. We have differences, says Jessalyn, but are equally special. Love it, love it, love it. Nicholas, your natural self and who you are is beautiful. Don't abide by other people's standards of beauty. I love it, I love it. Like there's that quote from Einstein, everyone's a genius, but if you judge a fish by his ability to climb a tree, everyone will think the fish is stupid. I love it, I love it. Everyone is different and beautiful in their own way. We should appreciate each other. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Agreed. Agreed, agreed, agreed. You all are understanding the message. My work as a storyteller is working. I appreciate it. So now let's get into why this is a story about diversity and inclusion. Most of us, right, are interested in a diverse national and global community in which human beings are able to thrive, right? Like the story at the end, they're able to thrive and use their gifts and talents for the benefit of the world, regardless of their race, right? Religion, nationality, ability, neural wiring, and other characteristics. But sadly, that is not what is going on. The Black Lives Matter movement, the killing of George Floyd, the killing of Ahmaud Arbery, the killing of Breonna Taylor, and much more. The list just keeps on going on and on. It's like we cannot open up our television screens without hearing another horrifying story of, at worst, police brutality in which someone loses their life, potentially because of bias and racial animus. But even if it's the light stories, right? Like many of you may remember the Christian Cooper story of that young man who went to my esteemed alma mater, Harvard. I don't remember if he went undergrad or grad, but he went there and he was a bird watcher and he's just minding his own business, watching birds. And when, you know, Miss Cooper comes up to him and says, Miss Cooper has her dog there. And Mr. Cooper's like, excuse me, your dog needs to be on a leash. She winds up calling the cops on him. And she yells, as she's on the phone with the cops, there's an African-American man harassing me, when we knew that he was doing no such thing. We saw the video footage. He wasn't threatening her in any way. So whether it's that case, which I'm not going to call benign because it is also painful, but if it at least does not end up in a killing or murder, right, we're happy. But in other cases, we have people literally, literally dying from issues of racial animus. So this is why diversity and inclusion has taken center stage right now. So you all are in an arena where very often you are hearing these terms, right? Diversity, inclusion, microaggressions, you're hearing all of this. But let's dig into it, okay? And let's actually discuss what exactly is going on here. So I'm going to share my screen in a moment. One moment. And we're actually going to discuss what these terms mean. So diversity, right? Diversity is, it's a discussion about the state of possessing unlikeness with respect to any dimension that can be used to create a distinction between human beings. That is what we are using as our definition of diversity. Do you see my screen now, everyone? Now let me open it up. Let me view in an expanded view. Great. So now let's think about these characteristics. So I have my slide with all of these characteristics, but I want you to put in the chat what exactly these characteristics are. What are the various diversity characteristics? When you are building an organization and you say that in order to unleash innovation, you want to make sure that you have all different types of diversity, what exactly are we talking about? Go ahead and put it in the chat. Come on now, right? So we all know race, but what else do we know? Put it in. Gender, race, ethnicity, sexual orientation. Thank you. I appreciate it. So that you are all coming up with this list, right? So in all my list, you see, let me go back. Biological sex versus gender identity, sexual orientation, race, ethnicity, immigration status, right? These are all different terms, socioeconomic status, skin tone, hair texture, religion or ethical system, political beliefs, parental or marital status. Take a picture of it if you want, you want to see this expansive definition. Age, you want people, millennials certainly have a different perspective than baby boomers. Educational background, a mental ability or brain wiring, right? There are some people who are technically orientated in their brain. There are others who are more right brain and they're more visual spatial, right? Physical attributes, physical ability, personality traits, right? These are all issues that you are thinking about when you're thinking about diversity and inclusion, right? And so when you are building an organization, you want to make sure that you are thinking about diversity, but you also do not want to exclude these two other concepts that are often being thrown around that I want to make sure that we have a clear working definition of. Inclusion, the extent to which the inherent value of diverse individuals is acknowledged and the degree to which diverse individuals are welcomed, accepted, integrated, empowered, or equitably treated within a group, organization, or institution. So we are making sure that they are there, but not that they're just there taking up space and making pictures look pretty, but they're actually involved. You're looking at your board and all the people of power and saying, do they represent the diversity that was on this slide? Do we have people that are bringing diverse perspectives, right? Next up, equity. You are also interested in ensuring that you are creating a state of fairness or similar opportunity for distinctly positioned individuals. What does that mean? It means that if you have a person who's distinctly positioned in that they have a wheelchair, your organization makes sure that your building is wheelchair accessible and that all of your events are catering to that person because you recognize that you want at the end everyone to have access to the same information and same events, right? This presupposes natural justice, fair conduct, and impartiality with respect to outcomes, right? So this is what we all want to get to. Diversity, inclusion, and equity. All of these incidents that have happened have sort of awakened the American consciousness to the fact that that's not really what we have. And many of us thought we had that, right? People thought we had that because we were beyond this. We were beyond a white only sign versus a colored only sign. We thought that we were beyond that, but institutional racism still exists and we are still struggling with it. So I want to define institutional racism. This is another term that many people are throwing around. Solid Ground, which is an organization, defines institutional racism as the systematic distribution of resources, power, and opportunity to the benefit of people who are white, and I would add, you know, if we were talking about not just institutional racism, but institutional bias, we would say white, we would say able-bodied, we would say cisgendered, we would say heterosexual, and the list goes on and on, potentially Christian, right? But this is just racism here. People who are white and the exclusion of people of color. Present-day racism was built on a long history of racially distributed resources and ideas that shape our view of ourselves and others. It is a hierarchical system that comes with a broad range of policies and institutions that keep it in place. And I'm just going to give you two examples, recent examples of how institutional racism still exists. So this is discussed in amazing detail, for example, when it comes to housing, in a book called The Color of Law. So I live in a community that is a part of that history, right? I live on Long Island, which is one of the most segregated places in the United States. I specifically live in Nassau County, which is one of the most segregated counties. We have a history of the Federal Housing Administration, which was established in 1934, promoting segregation by refusing to insure mortgages in and near African-American neighborhoods. This policy is called redlining. And meanwhile, the FHA was subsidizing builders like Levittown to create communities that were mass producing homes for people who were white and largely excluding people of color. There were racial covenants that said that homes could not be sold to anyone of color. And at the time, these houses were, let's say, $30,000. African-Americans would be able to afford it, afford those homes. Now these homes are worth $550,000. And this is seen as an interest-free loan from the government in which white people in Levittown were able to build intergenerational wealth through home ownership that African-Americans were unfortunately excluded from. And this supposedly ended in 1968 when you had the Fair Housing Act, but unfortunately, this type of segregation still happens to this day. There was a recent Newsday report in which they actually had African-American families posing as potential home buyers, and they were funneled to particular communities and excluded from others. We can also give the example of institutional racism as a criminal justice system, right? So many of you are aware of the war on drugs, which deeply affected the Black population. It affected the Black population severely through mass incarceration. It also affected the Black community greatly with respect to HIV transmission, because people are five times more likely to encounter HIV or to contract HIV when they are actually incarcerated. Right? There was a 100-to-1 disparity in sentencing for crack, which was primarily being used in Black communities, versus powder cocaine. So you can imagine, this is another example of du jour type of institutional racism, where the law is actually saying that people of, or the law is actually producing a result in which people of African descent are given more jail time. This was sort of reversed in 2010, in which the discriminatory ratio went from 100-to-1 to 18-to-1, which is still not good. So that is what we are discussing when we are talking about institutional racism. Please put in the panel, put in the chat, if you are understanding. So when people are using the term institutional racism, they're talking about the policies that are put in place, the government programs that are put in place that actually produce unfair, inequitable results, very often when it comes to race, gender, and all of these other markers or characteristics of diversity. Thank you so much, Nicholas, and I appreciate it. Phenomenal. I'm glad that you are with me on this. Okay, very good. So let's move on, okay? Because now this is our primer. Now when people say these terms, you will be very, very much aware. So unfortunately, because of all of these policies, when we just look, for example, and in another presentation, we will go into the whole gamut of US society. We'll talk about whites, Latinos, we'll talk about Asian Americans, we'll talk about American Indians. But right now, the focus tends to be on anti-Black racism because of all that is going on with respect to police brutality. I went to CNN and pulled up some very informative graphics for you on what the result of that is. So white families have substantially more wealth than Black families. Let's look at the median net worth of a white family in the United States, $171,000 versus a Black family, $17,600. So when people discuss the results of institutional racism and policies that were going on with respect to the FHA loans being given to white communities and not Black communities and how that impacts communities over time, this is the result that they are referring to. Additionally, when you think about what goes on with mass incarceration, people cannot build wealth if they are in jail. Clearly, right? So this also impacts wealth. It impacts income. So right here, this is another phenomenal chart, okay? And this is all available on CNN.com, in which you're seeing the average income for white families versus black families. We can go on and on and on with respect to the modern day vestiges of institutional racism. This is the unemployment rate for black people versus whites. This is the share of poverty for black people versus white, 20.8% versus 8.1%. It obviously impacts healthcare. These are the percentages of black people who are uninsured, 9.7% versus white people who are uninsured. And clearly, if you are uninsured, you are not going to a primary physician as often. And so horrible diseases like diabetes, okay, hypertension, complicated diseases that complicate all other bodily functions are not being detected and treated early. And that is part of the reason why you see the percentage of COVID deaths in the black community being so much higher than the rest of the population, 23% versus 13%. I'm gonna stop sharing now. I wanna speak to you. Racism is literally killing people in more ways than one. Please write in your comments. Please write in the chat. I wanna make sure that you're out there and that you are following this. So again, that's our primer on institutional racism. What is going on from a broader policy standpoint, which is causing lack of diversity, inclusion, and equity in so many arenas, all right? That is what people, this is why people are angry. This is why they're out in the streets. This is why we're seeing this turmoil in our society, because enough is enough, right? Enough is enough. When are we as a country going to be able to fulfill our mission of equal opportunity for all and really being a country in which all people's gifts and talents are being shared? Thank you, thank you, thank you. Okay, so I'm going to go back now and we're going to discuss other forms of bias. We are all a part of this. So many of you may say, I'm not a politician. You may say I was not in charge of the Federal Housing Administration. You may say I wasn't a part of the political community with the war of drugs when they signed all of these laws in which the sentencing for crack was 100 times higher than that for powder cocaine. But now we're going to get to something that you all can relate to, which is bias. All of us have it. We're continuing with our definition so that when you hear people discussing this, we're developing this sort of race, diversity, inclusion, literacy, bias, unreasonably hostile feelings or opinions about a social group, prejudice. Now, very often, bias can be both explicit and it can be implicit. Very often it's implicit. It's subtle and it's unconscious. These are attitudes that we possess without being aware that we possess them. Without even being aware. So we can't even stop it because we're not even aware of it. These are very often subconscious beliefs that we've absorbed from the media. Stereotypes, widely held but fixed and oversimplified ideas or images of a people. And one thing to know about the implicit beliefs is that very often they do not coincide with declared or conscious beliefs. It's very often revealed through actions rather than words. So when you think of explicit bias, this is obvious, right? And most of us can say, we are not a part of this. So for example, the bell curve, this is a book, okay, said that blacks were intractably and probably biologically inferior in intelligence to whites and Asians. Explicit. The bell curve is not mincing words. They're saying these people are intelligent, these people are not. You have the Ku Klux Klan that's explicit in their ban or their disgust with homosexuality. We support a national law against the practice of homosexuality, which would include the repeal of gay marriage laws. They are not being implicit. They're saying this is what we believe, right? Additionally, the KKK, America is being overrun by illegal immigrants, mostly from non-white countries. Immigration should remain open to only white Christians throughout the world. These are examples of explicit bias, but most of us disavow such things, but we are all guilty of implicit bias. And I shouldn't use the term guilt because that implies some sort of like moral blameworthiness. We live in a society in which we have a common culture that produces biases. That's it. And none of us are immune from that common culture. So this, for example, is a slide that sometimes I share when we want to reveal these biases. So very often people think of Asian Americans as being perpetual foreigners. I will read news articles about Asian Americans and they will refer to the Asian Americans as Asians instead of Asian Americans. Very often people are stereotyping them as being brilliant at math, but having poor social skills, being wealthy, and being wimpy and submissive. And this comes across in policies, of course, like the Japanese internment, but it also comes across in everyday life. So there was an OkCupid study that showed that Asian men were less likely to get responses from women of all races. And that's because of the stereotype of Asian men being wimpy or submissive, right? Latin Americans, Hispanics, again, stereotypes of them being illegal, foreigners, criminals, sexual deviants. And unfortunately, this is expressed with respect to immigration policy, as well as Latin American students or students of Latin American heritage in American schools being 2 to 5 more times likely to be disciplined in school. African Americans very often stereotyped as criminals, lack of intelligence, the idea that all people of African descent are the same. This was justification for slavery, mass incarceration. And then often we have another stereotypes, Native Americans seen as savages and animalistic drunkards. Very often we can tell these stereotypes. I'm gonna stop the share and just tell you these jokes through jokes. Jokes often, right, often, let us understand our bias. So I'm going to give you a few racialized jokes that are inappropriate. Do not repeat these, but at the point that you laugh, you will realize that you've been exposed to the stereotype. So this is one joke. A Black Jewish boy runs home from school one day and asks his father, "Daddy, am I more Jewish or am I more Black?" The dad replies, "Why do you want to know, son?" And the son says, "Because a kid at school is selling a bike for $50. And I want to know if I should talk him down to 40 or just steal it." Put in the chat whether you get the joke. I hope some of you don't get it because it's a terrible joke. But put in the chat whether you get the joke. I'm looking in the chat. Oh my God, Nicholas says, horrible. I get it. Thank you. Come on, keep on going. Do you get the joke? In order for you to understand the joke, you have to have been exposed to a racial stereotype, which very often will implicate itself in your life through your actions. You would have to be exposed to the stereotype of Black people being criminals and stealing, or Jewish people being cheap and always wanting to haggle people down. Unfortunately, this stereotype or bias comes out in language. People sometimes use the term Jew as a substitute for the word haggle or bargain, right? Thank you. This is the night, if you don't get the joke, God bless you. If you do get the joke, you recognize that you've been exposed to the stereotype. This is another joke, right? Just to let you know that these biases exist for everyone, okay? Why couldn't the Irish man become a lawyer? He could not get past the bar. Write in the chat whether you get the joke. What is the association for Irish Americans that allows that joke to be a joke? Right, if you get it, thank you. Elizabeth Johnson says people say that they are drinking. I have an Irish American friend I went to Harvard undergrad with, Dave, and Dave tells me he literally downplays his accent because he feels that people have lower job opportunities if people know that he's Irish because of this association. This is another joke. There are 3 families living in 3 apartments in 1 building, a Mexican family, a white family, and a Black family. A tornado hits the building one day, which family survives? The answer is the white family because the children are at school and the parents are at work. Write in the chat whether you understand the joke. What is the association? The association is this idea that very often non-whites are not hardworking. They are not contributing. They're not going to school. They're not going to work, right? And I'm gonna give you one last joke that just shows you your exposure to the bias. Why don't Italians like Jehovah's Witnesses? Answer, they are Italian. They don't like any witnesses. Write in the chat whether you get it. Write in the chat whether you get it, please. If you get the joke, you've been exposed to the stereotype. So very often, unfortunately, we live in a culture in which we are being exposed to stereotypes. It could be through movies, like, you know, gaudy movies and whatnot. It could be Boys in the Hood. It could be through movies. It could be through music. It could be through news reports. Most of us are being exposed to this bias. And unfortunately, it is having outrageous results in our lives. Very often, we are engaging in microaggressions. These are brief and commonplace daily verbal, behavioral, and environmental indignities, right? Whether intentional or unintentional. We're gonna go through this very quickly because we're pressed for time. Very often, they consist of micro assaults where people are like putting nooses and swastikas, cross burning, using the Confederate flags, or even using epithets. There are people who consider themselves to be good liberal people who still use the N-word, who still use all types of pejorative terms. These are microaggressions that very often people are engaging in. Micro insults, right? So now these are interpersonal environmental communications that convey stereotypes. I'll give you an example. So there's a stereotype of people of African-American being less intelligent and unworthy. When I was at Harvard for my first week and I had worked very hard to get in, I have 18 cavities in my mouth to prove it. I used to stay up every night drinking Mountain Dew to study for my AP and international baccalaureate exams. I show up my first week and he's a friend now, but we are in a discussion and I start speaking. And this young man says to me, "Oh my goodness, Ama, you're actually really intelligent. And all this time, I would have thought you were just here for affirmative action." This is a microaggression, a micro insult. He's basically telling me that because I'm Black, I don't deserve to be there. He's shocked that I'm actually intelligent when we're at the same school. He's acting as if they just went to, you know, Queens. I'm from Laurelton, Queens, and said, any 17-year-old Black girl or 18-year-old Black girl, get on this bus and you get to go to an Ivy League institution. But these are the type of comments that happen because of those stereotypes. So we can draw a line, right, between these sort of insults. You're only here because of affirmative action. Or the insult that's given to many people who are of Asian or Latin American heritage. Wow, you speak English really well. We can draw a line between these stereotypes and those microaggressions or comments. And all of us are capable of these. All of us are capable of. I'll give you an example from my own life. I had a colleague at my law firm, Cleary Gottlieb Steen in Hamilton, who told me that he was getting married. So he says, "Oh, Ama, I'm planning my wedding." And I say, "Oh my goodness, I am so excited for you, Ian. Who is the lucky lady?" Someone put in the chat, "What assumption I made." I said, "Who is the lucky lady?" Someone put it in the chat, please. What is the assumption that I made? That he was heterosexual. That is a microaggression. It could be considered a micro insult. Like I'm saying that homosexual or gay marriages are not as worthy as heterosexual marriages, or it could possibly be seen as a micro invalidation. I'm invalidating that type of marriage even exists. All of us are capable of these microaggressions because all of us have bias. We'll continue, and I'll give you some more examples of how, whether it's institutional racism or everyday bias, we are all in this. Right? So another example, Joe Biden said this when President Barack Obama was running, when he was then a candidate. "I mean, you got the first mainstream African-American who's articulate, bright and clean, and a nice looking guy. I mean, that's storybook, man." Joe Biden is not a racist, in my opinion, but he made this comment. What exactly is the microaggression here? What is his comment showing about his assumption? Right? He's assuming that it's so shocking to have an African-American man who's articulate, bright, clean, and nice looking. That storybook? I'm around handsome, good-looking, great, articulate African-American men every day of my life, my husband included, right? These are the type of micro insults that all of us are capable of engaging in. And then we have micro invalidations, which are environmental cues that exclude and negate and nullify the thoughts, feelings, or realities of certain groups, such as people of color. So what I just said, the mistake that I made, in which I assumed that my friend was marrying a woman because he's a man, that would be an example. Additionally, another micro invalidation that a lot of people engage in and they think it's not an invalidation is, "When I look at you, I don't see color." So everyone, we want you to see color. The moral of that story that I shared, Sune's gift, is that we want to see color and we want to embrace it and we want to enjoy it and we want to dig deep and learn more about it, right? So now, what are the consequences very often of all of these biases? So there was a study, it's called the White and Resume Study by Catherine DeSellis, in which basically they had the same set of resumes with the same sort of qualifications. Sometimes it had the person's real name, a name that may give their ethnicity away. Like let's say the name is Joanna Choi, Or the name is, let's think of a name that people might think is stereotypically Black, Raheem Johnson. They then took those same resumes and changed them. They took out all ethnic information. They changed the names. These were the results. 25% of Black candidates received callbacks from their white resumes, while 10% got calls when they left the ethnic details intact. Among candidates of Asian ancestry, 21% got calls if they used white resumes, whereas only 11.5% heard back if they sent resumes. Similar statistics, similar statistics. Let's go back to this slide over here. People did not know that they were engaging in stereotyping. They may have seen the name Joanna Choi and said, oh, this person's English may not be well. It might not be proper English because the person is foreign. They may have said, this person may not be hardworking because the person's of African descent. This is happening. And if we were to speak to any of those individuals, they would say, oh my goodness, never in a million years do I think that all Asians are foreigners, or all people who are Asian American are foreigners. Oh, by all means, I would never think that people who are of African descent are of lower intelligence, but it came through in their actions and behaviors. And we can draw a line from this sort of implicit bias to, let me go back to a prior slide here, to this poverty rate, or this unemployment rate, or this lack of income. Again, we are all a part of this. We are all a part of the everyday decisions that we make. There's another study that I'd like to share with you, and then we're going to wrap up soon so we can have Q&A. A leadership consulting firm named Nexion engaged in a study at law firms. I do a lot of bias training at law firms because I'm an attorney myself, so they get continuing legal education credit for it. They basically took the same memo. They put the same name on it, Thomas Mayer. In some cases, they said Thomas Mayer graduated from NYU Law School and was a third year African-American associate. On another, they said that he was a third year associate who was white American and graduated from NYU. The results of their screening for the same exact memo changed drastically. When they thought it was Black Thomas Mayer or Mayer Thomas Mayer of African American Thomas Mayer, the rating was 3.2 out of 5. And people wrote, we cannot believe he went to NYU Law with this bad memo. When they thought it was white Thomas Mayer, it was 4.1 over 5 out of 5. And people said he had potential and that they can work with him to develop his talent. It was the same exact memo. And this was a blind study. Again, we're going back to these stereotypes that all of us have been exposed to. These stereotypes influence their own view. Unfortunately, implicit bias is so strong that we can't even trust our own opinions about things, right? So now let's get into the meat of it. I'm gonna stop sharing at this point and really speak to you and look into your eyes. We're all in this together. Can you please put it in the chat, we're all in this together? Just as we're all in this together with respect to COVID-19, we are all in this together when it comes to creating a more diverse, inclusive, and equitable world. And all of us are part of it, and all of us have power. All of us have power. Alice Walker has a quote that the most important and powerful way that people take away the power of the oppressed is by leading them to believe that they have no power. We all have power to shift our world and our country in a new and better direction in which, like the story that I shared with you, Sune's gift, we have an understanding that all human beings are worthy and all human beings are valuable. So how exactly are we going to seize our power? What are the various everyday things that we can do and engage in? So one, it's important to know that institutional racism is institutional, right? It is institutional. We have to vote for politicians who care about diversity, inclusion, and equity. One of the longest standing organizations in the country, the NAACP, actually has a report card in which they basically rate legislators, congressmen, on what they are doing with respect to promoting just laws. And I'm going to actually put that link in the chat right now. So you can look up your various representatives to see how they performed and vote people out who do not care about diversity, inclusion, and an equitable world. Additionally, you can advocate, right? When there are like there are many laws that may be coming up surrounding police brutality, surrounding in California right now, there's potential legislation to make sure that corporate boards have diverse corporate boards. You can advocate. You can write to your officials and say, I really believe in this, and I believe that this is something that you can vote for. All of us have the power of voting. All of us have, if we're citizens, all of us have the power to advocate and to write. Even if you are not a citizen, you can write, right? It does not hurt. You can let them know you're not a citizen, but that you are a resident and that you want your voice to be heard. Next, patronize. So there, if we are going to get over what you saw in terms of the lack of equity when it comes to income and wealth distribution, and a part of that is historical, people's ancestors were enslaved for hundreds of years. They did not have an opportunity to build wealth during that time. If people are being incarcerated at higher rates due to unfair laws, they do not have opportunities to build wealth. If they are putting their resume in with their own name, which we all should be able to do, right? We should, Joanna Choi should not be changing her name to Joanna Smith, right? Joanna Choi should have a right to apply for a job with her own name. And if people are experiencing implicit bias as a result, we know that there's a great deal of work that needs to be done. So we can vote, we can advocate by writing letters, and we can patronize. We can support diverse businesses. Right now, if you go to Etsy.com, put in Black-owned businesses, there will be a number of independent sellers that come up. You can support businesses from communities that are not yours. You can support, you had delicious Caribbean food on your cruise at Jamaica. You can certainly support a Caribbean restaurant in your community. You go into Google Maps, Caribbean food. Chances are that will be a person of African descent who owns it. Soul food, African food. Every week you can support a diverse entrepreneur. This is so critical right now as we support our small businesses on Etsy, on it's Uber Eats and other platforms. Through using Google Maps and Google reviews, you can patronize diverse businesses. All of you have that power with respect to how you spend your money. Additionally, you can donate to organizations that are engaging in the fight. You can donate to the Black Lives Matter movement. You can donate to the NAACP. I donate to organizations that have been specifically important to my own success. When I was 13 years old, I received a scholarship to go to a Quaker boarding school called George School through a program called the Albert G. Oliver Program. And every year they send diverse students who are doing really well in school of African and Latin American descent to top boarding schools. And I had a phenomenal experience at my Quaker boarding school. It's George School in Newtown, Pennsylvania. If any of you have kids in middle school and you're open to boarding schools, I love my boarding school and I'm pitching it. The George School. You can support such organizations like the Albert G. Oliver Program. Email me, I'll share my contact information. I'll give you organizations. So you can vote, you can advocate, you can patronize, you can donate. Additionally, at your own organizations, you can recruit. You can say to yourself, we need more diversity on our team. And you can make sure that you are on LinkedIn looking at diverse candidates. And when they come in, you don't just say they're there. You want to make sure that you are mentoring them. Now, some of your organizations have formal mentoring programs where you match various newcomers with veterans. That's great. You can also have, you know, make sure that you have like a mentoring tea time, you know, or coffee break. And it can be a virtual coffee break during this day and age. You can do that. You can make sure you have hiring power. And then lastly, you can maintain mindfulness. When you engage in a slip up like a microaggression, you can apologize and validate that person. So when I was at, you know, at my law firm and I said, Ian, who's the lucky lady? He corrected me and I apologized. I said, I'm sorry, I apologize. And I said to him, you're marrying a man, even better. Okay, and I supported him and I, you know, attend his, they adopted two daughters, very sweet. Actually, I'm lying, they didn't adopt the daughters. They had a surrogate and an egg donor who were two different women. And through the surrogate and egg donor, they had two beautiful daughters and I support them and go to their events. You can support people, mentor them. You can apologize when you make a mistake. Realize all of us will make mistakes. We live in a world with a dominant story, okay? And the dominant story has all of these stereotypes that we discussed embedded. We would have to be living under a rock not to be exposed to bias. So our goal now is to own up to it and to be mindful. When we make a mistake, we apologize and we try better next time. Those are the things that we do. I'll share my screen right now so you'll see some of these tools that we are using for seizing our power. All right, so let's conclude and then we'll do Q&A. Our goal is to have firms, organizations that reflect the racial, ethnic, cultural, religious, political, economic, and thought diversity of our country. But very often, this is being thwarted by not just institutional racism, but implicit bias. Very often, we are not aware of the biases that we have. We have these microaggressions that are part of everyday life. I gave you examples of the microaggressions. They represent the general cultural landscape that all of us have been a part of, and that we are trying to unwind in order to create a better world. So right now, a better world. So individuals and organizations, we all have the power to change things. We are being mindful of the words that we say. We're being mindful of the hiring decisions that we make. We're being mindful of the businesses that we patronize and the politicians for whom we vote. We are seizing our power. I am here for you. This is my information here. This is my phone number. You see my phone number right there and my email address. I love giving these presentations. I love supporting nonprofits as well as corporations and schools and their desire to create a diverse and inclusive landscape. I have a team of other professionals who are equally talented, and we are here for you. And we want to support you in this. We want to provide training programs. We want to consult. We want to help you find diverse candidates. We are here for you. So please be in touch. All right, everyone, what are your thoughts? Can only be solved together. I agree with you, Eileen. We're all in this together. Thank you, Matthew. Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. Okay, Q&A, it's 1 o'clock. Let's go. Who has questions, please? Okay, so Jody says, referring to an individual with dark skin, should I say Black or African American? So now I'm glad that you asked this question. You have to ask the person because there are two issues. Some people have dark skin and they are not African American. African American refers to people who are ethnically African American, meaning their parents were brought to this country potentially, you know, in the 1600s or so as a part of the transatlantic slave trade. They often do not know, unless they've taken a DNA test, what tribes, what ethnicities, what places they're from. They don't know that they're of Ghanaian or Nigerian or Congolese descent. Their ancestors were brought here from the continent of Africa. Very often they're mixed. They have some American Indian or First Nations ancestry. They often have European ancestry because unfortunately slave masters very often raped enslaved women. So this is an ethnicity in itself. A person with dark skin who came from Jamaica yesterday may not identify as African American. My parents are from Ghana and I was born and raised here and I'm perfectly happy being referred to as African American, but there are some people who would say, no, that's not true, because someone who's similarly situated might say, my ancestors didn't come from Africa, you know, 100 years ago, right? So that creates some challenges, right? So I would say you have to ask, because African American does not refer to every person who is of African descent. The person may say, I'm Jamaican American, or I'm Cuban American, or I am, you know, what have you. They may not prefer that term. So you would have to actually speak to them individually. And then unfortunately, the term Black is linked with a lot of negative attributes, right, throughout history. If you look in the dictionary, Black is associated with, you know, evil and sinister nature. So some people don't appreciate that term either. I am fine with it because I think that we have to reclaim the term Black and make sure that we know that Black is beautiful, but I'm not everyone. So the answer is you really have to ask because it's very complicated. All right, next. Let's look in the chat. Thank you. My organization is looking to hire a part-time, potentially full-time in 2021 role. We've published a listing on Indeed. Our staff is majority white identifying. How can we attract a diverse pool of candidates? Thank you so much. Okay, wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. This is a great question. So you've posted it on Indeed. That is really great. There are a number of different tools where you could actually, this is a question, is this a lateral hire or could it be a newcomer? If it is a newcomer, meaning the person can be straight out of college, there are historically Black colleges and universities, such as Howard University, Spelman, Morehouse, et cetera. They have career services offices that would love to be in touch with you. Additionally, there are organizations. I'm a part of, for example, the Black Ivy Alumni Network. Black Ivy Alumni Network, we have a jobs board. You can partner with them to put it on their jobs board. There are similarly situated organizations like, you know, the, you know, Latinx Alumni Association of, you know, of any university. So those are the sort of tools that you need. You partner with organizations that already have a large database of people. And it depends really, I would have to know more. We'd have to speak more about potentially, you know, whether it can be someone straight out of college, whether it's a lateral hire, but you would massage your approach based on that and know that there are all of these resources. Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. Let's see what other questions. Oh, can be a newcomer. Great. If it can be a newcomer, then I mean, you literally have the world as your oyster. You have all those historically Black colleges and universities. You have clubs within organizations. Like I was a part of the Black Students Association when I was an undergrad. And I remember we used to have specific like employer meetings where they would come and recruit. So that makes it very, very easy. There's I don't know how much it costs though, but there is a platform called Handshake, which specifically puts you into a pipeline of students from various schools. So that makes it easy. That makes it very easy, especially when it's a newcomer. It's not hard if it's not, but that makes it easy. Okay, great, Ama. Your candor and loving delivery is appreciated. Thank you. Your focus on unity was very eye-opening to me and makes me comfortable as a white man who's trying to be a part of the solution. Thank you so much. Thank you, Tommy. I greatly appreciate that. We all are in this together and we have to feel comfortable because I recognize bias is a part of the human experience. And so we all have to own up to it. And so my goal is to provide some comfort in the discomfort. Thank you. What program should be in place to retain employees of color? Elizabeth Johnston, great question. Love this question, Elizabeth. Thank you so much. So I am still in touch with some of my mentors. So I had the privilege of working at really great companies. I did investment banking at Bank of America. I was at Cleary, Gottlieb & Steen in Hamilton. I literally just met with one of my old Cleary colleagues yesterday in my backyard. She happens to live in my neighborhood. I literally just got a text message from one of my city. When I was at Citigroup, which is the parent of Citibank, they had a mentorship program and I had a mentor that I keep in touch with. We were just texting each other or emailing each other on LinkedIn. Mentorship programs are really great. And this is something that I want to say to you all. We have to move into our humanity if we're going to do this work. Very often we were told, and I remember being told this myself, that you can't talk about your family, you can't talk about politics, you can't talk about, you know, your faith at work. But these are the things that make us human, right? And very often, if we're talking about the superficial things like your sailing trip, I've never been sailing. I've been skiing. I can count the number of times I've been skiing. I do like it. It's fun. But I can count the number of times. So very often when we're doing the superficial, we're not able to engage at a deeper level and retain diverse employees. So definitely engaging in a mentorship program. You know, it's like every mentor gets a $50 allowance to take their mentee out to lunch. You know, it's a reasonable lunch. I'm just saying this makes it very affordable. And you have them meeting all of the time and that you're encouraging an environment where we get to be human beings with each other so we can truly connect. Because again, very often, if it's a superficial, the superficial is dividing us based on socioeconomic class, socioeconomic status. I don't go skiing that often, not because I don't like skiing, but it's expensive, right? So very often we need to get to the humanity and we need to form these programs and encourage people to really have human conversations and to connect with one another. So through those mentorship programs, that is how you're able to retain people through getting to the humanity of the situation, Additionally, you want to make sure that you have, if you do not have a chief diversity officer, someone on hand is available to speak to diverse employees about what they might be experiencing in terms of microaggressions. There are studies that show many diverse employees are almost out the door because they've just had enough with the microaggressions. Maybe they went into the office with hair like this and someone said, your hair looks unprofessional. Or maybe a microaggression was that someone actually said that, you know, they were there because of affirmative action. If you're in that type of environment, you want to leave, because you're not comfortable and everyone needs to be happy. We spend so much time at work. We cannot afford to be unhappy. So make sure there's someone on your team who can field those conversations and that the person really has the type of temperament and the type of education to be able to handle those situations. All right, good. So that's my what should we do to retain employees of color, mentorship programs, developing a culture of humanity, okay, instead of just a superficial. And additionally, you're making sure that you have someone in HR who can help navigate these issues. So if they're experiencing microaggressions, there's someone they can speak to. All right, those are some of my tips. Any suggestions on how to best confront a microaggression or implicit bias? Thank you so much. Really great question, Nicholas. So if you are the receiver, I'm going to say this. Sometimes it's challenging in the moment. Once you have developed some mental clarity about the situation, you're going back and you're speaking on a very human level. When you said A, B, and C, I felt X, Y, Z. When you said A, B, C, I felt X, Y, Z. And you're using the term I felt. You're not going up to the person and saying, you racist son of a gun. I can't believe, no. We have to come from the perspective of this. You should be able to tell, or you may be able to tell, whether a person is being intentional or whether they just made a mistake. And if it's unintentional, we have to have some sort of understanding surrounding that lack of intentionality and the fact that they have to learn, and that they, if we don't teach, they won't learn. I'm not saying it's your job to be a teacher, because I hate that type of pressure. If you are a person of color at work trying to do your job is not to educate people. My job is to educate people. So hire me and I will do the diversity training and educate. So I'll do a presentation at your organization. So please bring me in. I get paid to educate. Thank you. I love it, right? It's a very enjoyable and meaningful work to me, but that's not your job. However, we recognize that people engage in unintentional mistakes and we want to give them credit for being unintentional, but we have to express our truth. When you said ABC, I felt XYZ. And you can go ahead and tell them your reasons. Have a very open dialogue with the person. And 80% of cases, when you're dealing with a mature, self-aware individual, they will say, oh my goodness, I'm sorry, I did not mean it. And now I know better for next time. You would like to make sure that they know better for next time. If you are uncomfortable, you are speaking to that HR professional or that diversity and inclusion person in order to facilitate a solution. But don't be silent about it, because we don't progress if we're not silent. And I'm saying this from experience, and I'm telling you, it is hard. When that barber made that comment, I didn't have the presence of mind to even say anything. I gave him a tip. I haven't been there since, but I gave him a tip. But then there was another incident in which something similar happened. My son had a chess teacher who said, how could you come into my class with that nappy hair? I didn't reprimand him in the moment, but afterwards I said, in my household, we affirm African textured hair. And so I don't appreciate that comment. You build the muscle. You build the muscle. All right, next up. Okay, we're running low on time. Yes, we are. Let's see. Any other suggestions? We have 39 people still on. Any last minute questions before we head out? I see Kenneth saying that we are running low on time. Any last minute suggestions? Or any questions or comments at the last moment? Please let me know. Well, it looks as if we might be, let me look in the Q&A. I've been in a couple of work settings that when the conversation of increasing diversity comes up, the response is often one of yes, that is important, but we need to focus on getting talented people. This response is a microaggression, if not racist, 100%, because the most talented people are diverse. What is the best way to respond to that line of thinking? Greatly appreciate this question. I'm so glad that I saw this before leaving. The way you respond to this line of question, in my opinion, is that you actually speak to them about the fact that diversity increases the innovation and the productivity of companies. And I, if you want to email me, we can give you plenty of examples of companies that did not have diverse teams and they got dragged through the mud and lost a great deal of business because they were unable to respond to the diverse needs of their market. So you are going to give them the business reason for why they need diversity. All of us have blind spots. And when we have diverse teams, we have people who are able to reveal those blind spots to us. There is an economic and a business imperative for it. So you're going to tell them that getting the most talented people includes, in my opinion, getting the most diverse people. And you may bring up some examples. So for example, Allure magazine one day did a cover story on how to get hair that looks like this. And they had a white woman on and they had showed them how, like maybe how to do a straw set to get the hair to be fluffy. Dragged through social media because people said, your magazine rarely puts Black women with kinky hair on covers. Why is it that now you're engaging in this appropriation and praising this hairstyle that very often is ridiculed in a professional setting, right? That is one example. I can give you tons of other examples. There was a shirt being sold, I believe it was at Target or Walmart, in which basically a child was made to look like a monkey. Again, stock goes down when these issues happen. So diversity is what actually makes the company better. This is my contact information. I am a resource for you. I literally cannot wait to do this program or a similar program we customize at your firm. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Okay, I'm putting my, oh yep, Danette put in my email address. I'm going to put the email address into everyone. It's on this slide, but I'm going to put it into all attendees. That is my email address. I cannot wait to work with your organization. I believe there's supposed to be some closing words.
Yep. So thanks, Ama. This is Ken. Thanks for sharing such a powerful message with all of us. I think it was extremely informative. It was awesome. Anybody who hasn't worked with Ama, they should definitely think about bringing her on and hiring her and having her help with their organizations and companies. This seminar or webinar will be posted on the NRH website as soon as we're able to get it together. Should be within the next few days. We'll also push it out to everyone who participated. Feel free to share it with others. And again, let's get Ama some business. Mm-hmm. We'll also be sending around, as Danette mentioned before, an evaluation form. Please consider completing it. Go to the NRH website and become a member of NRH. It's important because, again, it's trying to get these types of messages out there to the nonprofit sector. We're going to be getting out some newsletters and stuff and a whole lot of information. Again, as Danette mentioned, the purpose of NRH is to really provide a one-stop shop for everybody to come to and really gain some good information and insight into the nonprofit sector. And, you don't know what you don't know. You don't necessarily know where to go to get all that information. So if we can get it all under one roof, that's great. So thanks again, Ama. You were incredible. This was great. And thanks for sharing your message with us. It was special.
Thanks, everyone. Thank you so much for having me. Thank you.
Take care, everyone.